A Treatise of Satan's Temptations by Richard Gilpin. A Discourse of the Malice, Power, Cruelty and Diligence of Satan. Second part of Chapter 9. Of Satan's deceits in particular. What temptation is? Of tempting to sin. His first general rule. The consideration of our condition. His second rule. Of providing suitable temptations. In what cases he tempts us to things unsuitable to our inclinations. His third rule. The cautious proposal of the temptation, and the several ways thereof. His fourth rule is to entice. The way thereof in the general, by bringing a darkness upon the mind through lust. 2. Secondly, Satan having acquainted himself with our condition, makes it his next care to provide suitable temptations, and to strike in the right vein. For he loves to have his work easy and feasible, he loves not to go against the stream. Thus he considered Judas as a covetous person, and accordingly, provided a temptation of gain for him. He did the like with Achan. And hence, was it that he had the Sabaeans so ready for the plunder of Job. He had observed them a people given to rapine and spoil. And accordingly, Job's goods being propounded to them as a good and easy booty, he straightway prevailed with them. It was easy for him to draw Absalom into an open rebellion against his father. He had taken notice of his ambitious and aspiring humor, and of the grudges and dissatisfactions, under which he labored, so that providing him a fit opportunity, he engaged him immediately. According to this rule, where he observes men of shallow heads and low parts, he the more freely imposeth upon them in things palpably absurd. Where he takes notice of a fearful temper, there he tempts them with terrors and affrightful suggestions. He hath temptations proper for the sanguine complexion, and for the melancholy. He hath his methods of dealing with the lustful and wanton, with the passionate and revengeful. He hath novelties at hand, for the itching ear, and suggestions proper for those that are atheistically inclined. Objection. To this may be objected, that experience tells us Satan doth not always walk in this road, nor confine himself to this rule. Sometime he tempts to things which are cross to our tempers, and inclinations, etc. Answer. It is true he doth so. But yet the general rule is not prejudiced by this exception, especially if we consider 1. First, that Satan being still under the commands and restraint of the Almighty, he cannot always tempt what he would, but according to a superior order and command. Of this nature I suppose was that temptation of which Paul complained so much. He kept down his body, 1 Corinthians 9:27, upon this very design, that he might have it in subjection, and yet is he buffeted with a temptation, which expected an advantage, usually from the temper and frames of our bodies, for so much, I suppose, that phrase, a thorn in the flesh, will unavoidably imply, though it still leave us at uncertainties what the temptation was in particular. Here Satan tempts at a disadvantage, and contrary to this rule. But then we must know that, he was not the master of his own game. God expressly ordering such a temptation, as was disagreeing with the apostles' disposition, that it might the less prevail, or hazard him, and yet be more available, to keep him low, lest he should be exalted above measure, which was God's design in the matter. 2. Secondly, sometime our temper alters. As the tempers of our bodies in a sickness may in a fit, be so changed, that they may desire at that time, what they could not endure at another. A special occasion or concurrence of circumstances, may alter for the time our constitution, and so an unusual temptation may at that time agree with this design. 3. Thirdly, sometime by one temptation Satan intends but to lay the foundation of another. And then if purpose he begins with a strange suggestion, either to keep us at the gaze, while he covertly doth something else against us, or to move us to a contrary extreme, by an overhasty rashness. 4. Fourthly, sometime he tempts when his main design is only to trouble and disquiet us. And in such cases the most unnatural temptations, backed with a violent impetuousness, do his work the best. 3. Thirdly, Satan's next work is the proposal of the temptation. In the two former he provided materials and laid the trains. In this he gives fire, by propounding his design. And this also he doth with caution these several ways. 1. First, he makes the object speak for him, and in many he is scarce put to any further trouble, the object before them speaks Satan's mind, and gains their consent immediately. Yet is there no small cunning used in fitting the object and occasion, and bringing things about to answer, the very nick of time, which he takes to be advantageous for him. 2. Secondly, sometime he appoints a proxy to speak for him. Not that he is shamefaced in temptation, and not always at leisure for his own work, but this way he insinuates himself the more dangerously into our affections, and with less suspicion, using our friends, relations, or intimate acquaintance to intercede for a wicked design. He did not speak himself to Eve, but chose a serpent. He thought Eve would sooner prevail upon Adam than the serpent could. He tempted Job by the tongue of his wife, as if he had hoped that what so near a relation had counseled, would easily be hearkened to. He tempted Christ to avoid suffering by Peter, under a pretense of highest love and care, "Master, spare thyself," Matthew 16:23. Yet our Savior forbears, not to note Satan's temptation closely twisted, with Peter's kindness. At this rate are we often tempted where we little suspect danger. 3. Thirdly, if he finds the two first ways, unhelpful or unsuitable, then he injects the motion, and so plainly speaks to us inwardly himself. "Do this act, take this advantage for pleasure or profit," etc. He thought it not enough to tempt Judas, by the object of gain, but he break his mind in direct terms, and put it into his heart, John 13:2. He did the like to Ananias, whose heart he filled with a large motion for that lie, and backed it with many considerations of the necessity, and expediency of it, Acts 5:3. There is no question to be made of this. Dr. Goodwin gives clear proofs of it, and so do several others. When we consider that thoughts are sometime cast upon the minds of men, which are above their knowledge, and that they say and do things sometime, which are far beyond any of their accomplishments and parts, and yet in the nature of it wicked, we must be forced to run so high as to charge it upon Satan. Thanks.